And how would we? Yasola Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jai Hurad Omatova Kundabihari. Jai Hurad Omatova Kundabihari. Gopi jana bala ba giri varada hudi Gopi jana bala ba giri varada hudi Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Jamuna Te Rabana Chagare Yamona Tera Panachahudi Jayurad Madhuva Kunjabihati Jayo Radham Haruva Kunjabihuti Jai Om Vishnu Pad Paramahansa Paramahansa Also Tera Satishi Shimad His Divine Grace Abhaya Chalanada Bhaktivedanta Goswami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. ISKCON, Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Ananta Koti, Vaishnav Vrind Ki Jai. Namacharya Shidhuidas Thakur Ki Jai. Purem Se Kaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shidwaita Gadadha Shri Vasudhi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Gajai Shri Shri Radhakrishna Gopika Bhatta Sayam Kun Radhakunda Giri Govardhan Gijai Vrindavanam Gijai Maturidam Gijai Jagadatha Sami Gajai Yamunamai Gajai Shrimati Lasi Devi Gajai Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda Gajai Gaur Premananda Hari Hari Bo. All glories the assembled devotees, all glories the assembled devotees, all glories the assembled devotees. All glories to Shri Guru in Gauranga, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Gaur Premananda. So today we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 16th chapter, text 56. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So even though it's Panihati Day, we're going to be talking about Panihati on Sunday. So I thought today we just do the Bhagavatam. Kaliya Uvacha Vayam Kalaha Sahotpatya Tamasa Dirga Manyavaha Swabhava Dushyacho Nata Lokanam Yad Asad Graha Kaliya Uvacha Vayam Kala Sahotpatya Tamasa Dirga Manyavaha Svabhavo Duschacho Nata Lokanam Yada Sadgraha Kaliya Vacha Vayam Kala Sahutpatya Tamasa Dirga Manyavaha Svabhavo Duschacho Nata Lokanam Yadna Sadgraha Kaliya Vacha Vayam Kala Sahutpatya Tamasa Dirga Manyavaha Subhavo Dushchacho Nata Lokanam Yadna Sadgraha. Vacha Okay. Kaliya Vacha. Kaliya said. Vayam we. Kalaha envious. Saha Upatya. By our very birth. Tamasaha of ignorant nature. Dirgamanyavaha. Constantly angry. Svabhavaha, one's material nature. Duschachaha is very difficult to give up. Nata, O Lord. Lokanam, for ordinary persons. Yat, Because of which? Asat of the unreal and impure. Graha, the acceptance. So translation. The serpent, Kaliya said, our very birth as a snake has made us envious, ignorant, and constantly angry. Oh, my Lord, it is so difficult for people to give up their conditioned nature by which they identify with that which is unreal. So you can repeat. The serpent, Kaliya said, our very birth as a snake has made us envious, ignorant, and constantly angry. Oh, my Lord, it is so difficult for people to give up their conditioned nature by which they identify with that which is unreal. So purport by the servants of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, Srila Sanatan Goswami points out that because of his wretched condition, Kaliya was unable to compose original prayers to the Lord. And thus he paraphrased some of the prayers offered by his wives. The word asadraha indicates that a conditioned soul seizes upon impermanent and impure things such as his own body, the bodies of others, and other countless varieties of material sense objects. The ultimate result of such material attachment is frustration, disappointment, and anguish. A fact that has now become crystal clear to the poor serpent, Kaliya. Again, the verse Kaliya vacha vayam kalo sahotputya tamasa dirgamanyavaha svabhavo duschajo nata lokanam yad asad grahaha. So, Om Ganat Milanda Shah. Gananjana Shalakya Chakshur Unmiditam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. So I have a problem with what Kaliya is saying. So I have several problems. One is, let's start with the beginning problem I have. First problem is that he took his birth as a snake because of the offense he committed in his past life. And I've told that story before, but just very briefly, the story is that he was a sage meditating in his cave. And people generally have this sense of possession. You know, not just people. I would say all living entities have a sense of possession. And I've mentioned before the dogs, they mark their boundaries. Just like yesterday, I was walking in the park, chanting my japa, and people had dogs, and one dog, none of the dogs attacked me, but the dogs were attacking each other because they had impinged upon each other's boundaries. So this particular sage, and I forget his name right now, but it's not important. He had his cave. It's my cave. My cave and my entry to the cave and my whatever. And another sage said, you know, can I join you? And he said to the sage, no. You know, he made faces. And he said, you are hissing like a snake. Therefore, become a snake. And of course, generally when sages curse, they actually give some sort of benediction connected with the snake, with the curse. Just like Manigriva Nalakuvara, they were cursed by Narada Muni, and the benediction that they would see Krishna. It's not such a bad benediction. So so as a result of that, so he, first of all, what I'm talking about today is responsibility. Taking responsibility for your particular actions, okay? So first of all, the body was because of his fault, not because Krishna just somehow or other decided, let me put this poor guy in the body of a snake so he can suffer and become envious. So if you have a body, not if, sorry. That's not an if question. You have a body. And the body is evidence of your previous actions, desires, karma. Face it. Just face it. Don't deny it. And of course, you know, the body is also there for devotees. Krishna puts you in situations where you can, let's say, experience some misery so you become detached from the material world. And that's also there, too, for devotees. from one lifetime to another. So this Kaliya was actually a devotee in his last life. So it was Krishna's arrangement. Just like the arrangement of Bart Maharaj. Okay, that's the first problem I have with Kaliya's excuse here. So in the course I give about empathic communication, there's these four D's of discommunication, and one is denial of responsibility. And usually I give certain examples. I don't usually give examples of past life stuff, but usually I give examples of someone who says, I drink too much because I'm an alcoholic. You know, so people have these excuses like that. Or I'm depressed because I'm depressed, you know, whatever. I mean, obviously, sometimes there's some physiological thing going on, and we're not being unnecessarily, hopefully, unnecessarily cruel when we're talking about things like this. You know, there are certain deficiencies that one may have. But we find many examples of people, and not just people, but entities that are born in lower species of life or naturally envious species of life that don't succumb to their physical nature. They're more aware of their physical nature. Of course, this is called, in Bhagavad Gita, called Buddhi Yoga. We know that there's eightfold material elements, Vina Prakriti Ashta, earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and false ego. And we know by reading the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, which we just finished, and we're on the third chapter in our studies, finally I found out that the body is like a chariot. After all these years in the Hare Krishna movement, I finally understand that analogy. So the body's like a chariot, the horses, the senses, and the mind is the reins, Manashakshtani and Driyani, and the driver is the intelligence. So when we talk about buddhi, intelligence, and it's interesting, a buddhi, Prabhupada sometimes said, the intelligence is the form direction of the super soul. So in other words, 15:15 in the Gita, that when you have some desire, you know, matak smritir, jnanam apovanam cha, Krishna gives you specific intelligence to direct the senses and to direct the mind. Okay. So Buddhi Yoga basically means that you have to control the mind. Since, I mean, why do we have these verses like, what's Vacho Vegam, Manasakrota Vegam, Jiva Vegam, Udarapashta Vegam? You know, the pushing's there. Prabhupada said that even when may become a pure devotee because of the body he has, then he just simply has to tolerate. You know, this word tolerate is there. And it, you know, it appears very cruel when we tell people, you have to tolerate Prabhu. But basically, it's a fact. You have to tolerate the pushing. So anyway, getting on to some examples to prove my point, because examples are actually important. Let's say, here's Kaliya, snake body. Okay. Let's pick some other people with snake bodies, or people. Let's pick some other entities with snake bodies. I mean, I'm not into this whole idea that many devotees have talked about, that our leaders are snakes and they have show pictures, you know, conspiracy. And they show pictures of someone's tongue, you know, the president's tongue coming out and it's forked. So this is crazy. But, all right, entities in snakes' bodies. Of course, Anantashesh. Of course, his body is transcendental. Okay, let's leave that one aside for right now. Vasuki. Vasuki's a good snake. He's born in a snake body, yet he's a good guy. You know, he's not a bad guy. It's not that all the snakes, it's not all the sons of Kudru were just like nasty creeps. That some of them are actually were nice people. Yeah, sorry, nice snakes. Some were nice snakes. So there's another example of a snake. I'm giving snake examples, then I'll get into other living entities. Narada Muni had a disciple who was a snake, right? And as soon as he took initiation and chanted on his beads, became Krishna conscious. I don't know how he chanted on his beads, but at least he could chant the Gayatri mantra. So as soon as he took initiation, he became peaceful. He controlled his nature. He took responsibility for his nature. Then people started to torture him, you know, harass him. You know, obviously, you know, if you find a snake around here and he's just like peaceful, can you imagine, you know, walk outside and one of these copperheads, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. You know, our natural response when we see a snake, isn't it? To take a stick or to, anyway, just want to kill the guy. So he went to his guru, and his guru complained to his guru. And he said, Narada Muni, these people are harassing me. I can't do my bhajan properly. And Narada Muni said, just raise your hood and go, hiss. And people get scared. And it's scary. I mean, I've seen cobras, and they raise their hood sometimes. I go, Hare Krishna, I better worship Govardhan more so I don't get harassed by the snakes. So it is kind of scary. So anyway, so there's another example of a snake. Okay, let's change the subject matter and go to other living entities now. Okay, so here is another example. Bart Maharaj took the body of a deer. Deer are usually not self-controlled, as far as I've experienced in this world. And so what happened is that Bart Maharaj didn't hang out with the other deer. Was he a male deer or a female deer? I don't know. Doesn't say. I just assume he's probably a female deer. Anyway. Who knows? I mean, we're just speculating. Okay. So he took a... he could have taken a birth as a female deer. So anyway, Anyway, so he took birth as a deer. And naturally, the body would have some inclinations. The deer body. And this is not a Walt Disney film. You know, where the deer talk and everything. What he did is he hung around with the sages. He didn't get into deer nonsense. Or actually, for deer, it's not nonsense. It's their natural proclivities. So there's another example. Controlling by intelligence. Intelligence is not based on the body. At least that type of intelligence, you know, the spiritual intelligence. There is a type of intelligence and mind that's based on the body, but the spiritual intelligence. Another example, let's go on to, let's see, we got more. Human beings. Oh, actually, forget about human beings right now. Don't forget about them. But we have in the Ramayana, we have these bears and monkeys. Some of them succumb to their nature. And some of the din, like Hanuman's a Kim Purusha. I mean, it's almost a human being, or is it a human being? So you have Hanuman and Sugriv, right? Basically the same species. Because Sugriva was the son of the sun god. Bali, of course, was the son of Indra. And so you have Hanuman, who perfectly controls his senses. He's going through the woman's ashram, looking for Sita Devi. He's flying. And that woman's ashram, of course, is the ashram of Ravana's wives that he had kidnapped, all these beautiful girls. And he's thinking, this is described in the Valmiki Ramayana, he's thinking, what the heck am I doing here? I'm a brahmachari, and I'm flying through the woman's ashram, and all these women are like half-dressed, or even, you know, God knows how they were dressed, and all drunk, and lying there completely disheveled, looking for Sita Devi. And then he remembered, this is Ram's service. So he didn't succumb to that natural nature. And then you have Sugriva, who, when he finally got back his kingdom, after Ram had killed his half-brother, Bali, that he really succumbed to his monkey nature. I mean, he was hanging around even with his brother's wife, what to speak of his own wife, and getting completely intoxicated. So you see, you know, they're actually basically the same type of body because, you know, from the demigods, like that. So it's a question of controlling your higher self with your lower self. I mean, sorry, controlling your lower self with your higher self. And that's what Buddha Yoga is. So, and even you have the example of Lord Chaitanya somehow giving his mercy to Shivananda Sen's dog. And, human beings again, or rakshasas. You have Vibhishan, who was born in a rakshasa family. And Vibhishan became a good guy. He had the same mother, same father. Kekashi was his mother. And it says that the sons take after the mother. And the daughter, generally, takes after the father. So his mother was a rakshasa, demon. His father was a nice guy, actually. And then he became, controlled his lower nature, even though he was a rakshasa. And his associates, he had described he had four associates who joined Ram. And these associates also controlled their lower nature with the higher nature, with their intelligence. That's why it's very important for us to understand the philosophy of Krishna consciousness, to discriminate. Prabhupada said discrimination is the better part of valor. And so, therefore, in ourselves, okay, let's apply this, because according to the laws of learning, I'm supposed to talk about applying application. Thank you, my dear teacher. So let's apply this to ourselves. And let's apply this to the word can't do or impossible. And Prabhupada, you know, famous quote from Prabhupada where Prabhupada said, impossible is a word in a fool's dictionary. So many times we think we can't do something. Let me give an example, I mean, before I go on to ourselves. Another example of one person who I knew here in Hillsboro many, many years ago. And he was basically a quadriplegic. That means he didn't really have use of his arms and not really use of his legs. And he opened up a store. It was a, at that time, I guess it was a UPS drop-off store and a whatever. They sold all sorts of stationery there. And I went in there, and he was operating a computer. In those days, computers were actually a little more primitive than they are nowadays. And he was operating a computer and running his business. He put a pen or a pencil or something like that, some sort of marker, in his mouth. And he was going like that and typing. And he was typing quite nicely on the computer. And he was disabled, perfectly able, I mean, nobody would have argued for him to get SSI from the government. Nobody would have argued with him. Obviously, you know, you'd take one look at him. But he didn't accept that particular situation. He wanted to do something. And then the devotee's devotee example is when the devotee said to Srila Prabhupada that it is impossible to produce 17 books in 2 months. And I was there for the whole thing. I witnessed it personally with these very eyes. It's not just the Prabhupada said story or in the tape or in the recording. That Prabhupada basically told them impossible is a word. Even though devotees wanted to reduce Prabhupada's request to like 2 books or 4 books in 2 months or over 6 months producing the books, Prabhupada just said, it's all useless. And it was a very heavy statement. He said, all these machines, because I was in the BBT building, And it was an, it was actually a new building we had just acquired for the ISKCON Press, or BBT. I was there, and I had helped show Prabhupada some of the machines. You know, and I was proud of it, you know, how I am about technology with all this doodads and everything like that. So I wanted to show off in front of Prabhupada, and the rest of us did too. So there was this, you know, typesetter with punch tape in it and like that, the old style computer. And there was a telex machine where the devotees could say all glories to Srila Prabhupada from New York. I remember that. It was quite interesting. What? This is in L.A., yeah. Yeah, I used to live in L.A. Yeah, it was on, Watsika. It was actually on Venice. The building was on Venice Boulevard, not on Watsika Avenue. The new building we got. Yeah, they don't, I think they rented it or whatever. They don't have that building anymore. So anyway, so Prabhupada said, all this is useless. And I was thinking, oh my God, all this wonderful gadgets, you know, computers, you know, not like I have now. Now Prabhupada would really like lay into me. But anyway, he said, all this is useless unless you could produce 17 books in 2 months. But he said, useless. And that also meant, you know, we took implicitly, that means you're useless too. So, okay, yes, sir. No more mental platform. 17 books, 2 months, a.k.a. Kurunandana, Bahushatus Randas Ja. Let's go for it. And so it happened. You know, I've told the story many times. And then also in Prabhupada's own life, where his spiritual master said, preach in the West and preach in English. And people thought, some of his godbrothers and some of the other people thought, this is impossible, you know, the whole world taking up Krishna consciousness. But Prabhupada did not accept that. Prabhupada did not accept that. Prabhupada accepted the word of his spiritual master, and then all the incarnations of the Lord were rowing the boat, you know, taking him over to God bless America, taking him over to America and assisting Prabhupada. And the success potency is built into the words of the spiritual master. So in our own personal lives, we are making so many excuses why we can't do something. I mean, it's a fact. And Prabhupada said, basically, you're Americans, you should do something, basically, I'm paraphrasing, do something miraculous or miracle, whatever it is. You should do something. And Prabhupada expected each and every one of us to be qualified in Krishna consciousness. And then we're making excuses. You know, I have this. I mean, there's certain physical disabilities we may have that we can't do certain physical things we used to do. That's a fact. I mean, that's a fact. But as far as preaching Krishna consciousness, as far as the present situation where we find ourselves locked up and perhaps getting cabin fever. For those of you who don't know what cabin fever means, it means during the winter, sometimes people feel very locked up and they don't do anything. But there's opportunities. A devotee doesn't see, I mean, someone who's determined, doesn't see problems, he sees opportunities and challenges. And we take, oh, sorry, I don't want to use that expression about the bull by the horns. That's a horrible example. We take life by the horns. Yeah, when he wanted to kill them. He didn't kill them. Well, I think Arista Shura. Okay. Sacha. Yeah, that's right. He took those bulls and he tied them all up. Okay, I can use that expression. So we have to take life and just like go for it and accomplish something for Krishna and not be in this denial of responsibility like Kaliya is doing here. You know, really take responsibility. I made a mistake. Please forgive me. It's not the fault of my body. It's not the fault of my mind. It's that I chose to do something or not do something. And you take, that's the first point, is taking responsibility for your actions. Once you've taken responsibility for your actions, you can transcend your bodily nature. I mean, you serve Krishna according to the varna. I understand that. We're not asking you to transcend your varna. But we're asking you to do something that transcends your maya, your lust, anger, greed, illusion, envy. By tolerating it, that's the point. It may be there, yes. You know, Kaliya has this body, and even after he became Krishna conscious, he still had the snake body. So even we join the movement, and we may have a body that's with a crazy brain, sorry. We may have a body that's lusty, more lusty than other people. We may have, I'm talking about things we can control, okay? Not to criticize people for, you know, the, if you have knees that don't work and you can't stand, that's not my point. But we have certain things that we can overcome by the strength of intelligence, by the strength of our philosophy. But it's very important to learn the philosophy. Otherwise, everything's just so damn sentimental. And last night in the class, we were reading that famous quote that Prabhupada said, you know, religion without philosophy is what? Sentimental. Sentimental. That's what Prabhupada said in the quote we read yesterday. And philosophy without religion is mental speculation. So you need the philosophy. So, and of course, I was using the example last night of why we need the philosophy to ascertain what is bona fide spirituality or a bona fide guru. Like Prabhupada gave the example of gold. You know, sometimes there's this thing called pyrite, which is fool's gold. And if you don't know what real gold is, we still got a few minutes. If you don't know what real gold is, you're going to be fooled. And someone's going to sell you a piece of land, at least, of course, that was in the Old West, where they were opening up California, and they said, oh, there's all this beautiful gold on the property. We'll sell it to you for 10 rupees. Not rupees. We'll sell it to you for $10. And it was all pyrite. It was all just useless because the person didn't know what gold is. So unless you understand the philosophy, you won't be able to discriminate. And unless you apply the philosophy, then what's the use anyway? You know, you can understand philosophy. You know, you're not the body. You're not the mind. You're not the senses. And then when it comes to it, you know, someone brings you a big plate of whatever that's going to hurt your health or whatever it is, or some pretty girl comes, hi, sweetie. So then you don't understand the philosophy. The philosophy is meant to be applied. You tolerate. Yes, I have the desire to eat that whole thing. I remember one time I was in Mayapur and I was with a devotee who paid for the whole maha plate, and he said, Maharaj, it's all for you. At that time, I wasn't an austere, dedicated rascal. So, you know, so I said, wow, it's for me. But anyway, so we have to say, you know, I wanted to consume the whole thing. And certainly with my eyes, I was capable of doing it. So you know, philosophy, okay, vacho, vega, manasa, you remember it. That's why we have to hear the basic philosophy over and over again. And, you know, we think we're transcendental. I'm a gopi, I'm a mundri. Yes, next life I'll be a young girl. But not a mundri. Because of all the torture I've given to the poor girls here, you know. But anyway, so we think all these things about our spiritual body, but, you know, we have to get back to the point of control. And that's why Prabhupada, and I've been commenting on that in my recitation of the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. You know, why does Prabhupada keep repeating, why does Krishna keep repeating himself over and over again? Don't, you know, you're not the body, you can't die, can't be burnt by fire, withered by the winds. All right, already, you know. Because we haven't applied it yet. So you really have to keep reminding yourself about these things. So anyway, just to end the class, we are responsible. We should use buddhi, intelligence, in applying Krishna consciousness. And, okay, there was another thing I wanted to add. This is actually, oh yeah, and be careful about contemplating sense objects, because we understand thinking, feeling, willing. And now we're just not just talking about subtle sense, gross sense objects. We're talking about subtle sense objects, you know, conceptions about ourselves that we may have imbibed by reading our horoscope, or conceptions about ourselves that have been taught to us by our parents, or conceptions about ourselves that have been taught to us by society. So these are subtle things we concentrate. I am this type of person. And we're not talking about varnashram. We're talking about upadis, designations that have been implanted on our consciousness and subconsciousness. If we contemplate them more, you know, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this. That's a contemplation of a subtle sense object. You become attached to it. You become, you know, lusty in the sense that you won't give it up. And then you get angry if someone challenges your conception of yourself. So anyway, so sorry about this. So we have about 20 seconds anyway. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so we cultivate the mode of goodness, obviously. Even though our body may be inclined towards certain activities, they're in different modes of nature. We can cultivate the mode of goodness with transcendental knowledge, with right association, and especially by chanting the holy name and seeing the deities, which we will see in a second. Okay, thank you very much. Hope I didn't offend too many people.
Pretty mountain.
Turn down the volume on this thing. Excuse me. Why don't I just leave the volume where it's supposed to be? Hare Krishna.
All right.
May I'm
Divine grace by Achananda Bhaktivananda Goswami Srila Prabhupada. ISKCON, founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Gijai. Ananda Koti Vaishnav Vrindi Gijai Namacharya Srila Vedas Thakur Gijai. Rem Se Gaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sidvaita Gadhadha. Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktivananda Gijai Shri Shri. Radha Krishna go bhagavata sayam kun radha kunda kiti govardhan kijai vrindavanam kijai maturidam kijai jagannatha swami kijai yamunamai kijai shrimati gavasude kijai sama veda bhakta vrinda kijai gaur premananda hari hari go. All glories the assembled devotees, all glories the assembled devotees, all glories the assembled devotees, all glories to Shri Guru Gauranga Srila Prabhupada kijai. Read the translation. When will that opportune moment come to me when I shiver upon chanting the name of Lord Gauranga? When will I cry while chanting Hare Krishna? When will I receive the causeless mercy of Lord Nityananda so that my desires for material enjoyment become insignificant? When will my mind be purified of material anxieties and desires so that I can understand Vrindavana? When shall I be very eager to study the books left by the six Goswamis so that I can understand the conjugal love of Radha and Krishna? The lotus feet of the six Goswamis are my only shelter. In constant separation from them, I remain Narottama Das. Narottama Das Thakur Ki Jai. So we'll see if anyone has any questions. Let me just go back to my studio.
One thing I want to mention
in regards to that last question in class is that there's a very interesting verse in that says that one should not hate or long for attachment and ignorance and other things when they come. So in other words, one may be subject to these things. In other words, there may be ignorance in the body or ignorance in the association or something like that. It's a question of philosophically or intellectually, or however you may put it. Let me make sure this is working. Somehow or other just tolerating according to the Bhagavad Gita, because these things will come from the body. So let's see. Oh, another point I wanted to make in class before I take questions from the devotees here is that Prabhupada was actually discouraged tremendously by his godbrothers before he came to the West. So had he accepted that? So in other words, we are confronted, all of us are confronted with discouraging words coming. And particularly, I mean, let's talk about how people tell the ladies in our movement, you can't do this, you can't do that, because you have to fit into some, like, you know, some square box or something like that. And so people start to live the words that they've heard over and over again. And sometimes children, you know, they hear the words, when you grow up, you'll never be intelligent or whatever. And then they start to live that. So teachers have to be very careful not to implant that in people's minds. And but even if we have some of those things implanted in our minds, in our consciousness, we don't have to live those things. We can actually transcend those things using higher intelligence. So any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna Gurudev, Dandavat Pranam Maharaj.
Hare Bal.
Hare Krishna Gurudev, Dandavat Pranam.
I know, I hear you.
No question, Gurudev. I have from previous classes, but I have written it down 6-7 questions. I will write to you, Gurudev.
No, ask me tonight.
Okay, Gurudev.
Tonight's class. All right. Okay, if there's no other questions, good to see everybody. And thank you all for joining us. It's been very enjoyable.
Can I ask from previous classes, Gurudev, from last week?
Yeah, ask me tonight.
Okay. Now?
Okay. Not now. Now is okay. Not tonight.
All right.
Hare Krishna, Gurudev, is Chitraleka.
Oh, Chitraleka. All right, Mexico. You have a question?
Yes, it's my internet signal is not working very well, so I missed the part where you said Prabhupada said that impossible is a word, and that's what I left.
Okay, impossible is a word in the fool's dictionary. In other words, okay. Devotees don't have the word impossible in their dictionary. We go through the Webster's dictionary and we erase that word.
Okay, right. Okay. Thank you very much. Receive my obeisances.
Hare Krishna.